and the third session, third masterclass. First was by Sachin Khedekar on acting. Yesterday we witnessed a beautiful presentation by Sushrut Vaidya on musicality of Raj Kapoor. And today it is about post-production, digitization and restoration. Cinema din ba din technical hote ja raha hai, and what is the technique behind it, and whether it is wo content pe habi hote ja raha hai ya kya hai, and how technique is used or misused. Today Mr. Mohan Krishnan is here to share his presentation. He is head of corporate communication, Prasad Corporation. I would welcome him on the dais. It's all yours.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Okay, to be honest with you, I'm a bit scared because I see a lot of super seniors sitting here. And the other side why I'm scared is that I see a bit of youngsters also. You know, it can go wrong in both sides now. So I think I have to strike a balance somewhere. Okay, before I begin, I would just like to take 2 minutes on explaining what I am and why I am here. I represent Prasad Group, which, as you may be aware, was a grand old group started by Mr. L.V. Prasad, who made so many beautiful films in those days and built the so-called empire that we all enjoy today, we as employees of Prasad. There are about 2,000 people working worldwide today for Prasad, who made all his films in Hindi right here in Bombay. And one small memory of Mr. L.V. Prasad, when he worked as a ticket collector in Dreamland Cinemas of Bombay in those days, in his struggle to come up in life as a filmmaker, and subsequently, when one of the films he made, Kilona, ran for 25 weeks in that same theater, and he took the privilege of coming all the way to that theater, stood in the gate, and he wanted to again give the tickets to the people, you know, check it and send them in. With that humility in the background, I would now like to tell you that I don't want to talk about Prasad Group, what we do and all that right now, that we may take as we go along. Now, in what capacity I am here to talk about this, whatever we are going to talk about today. First and foremost, I would like to tell you that I am talking like a common man who loves films. You see, I feel that's a very important thing to do. In the midst of all these technologies, paraphernalia, so many things, we seem to just get carried away. That is the angle I want to take today. We will talk a little bit about technology, which to me, and which to most of the youngsters, or even the older people here, might actually be insignificant. It doesn't make any difference. I mean, what difference does technology make, you tell me? I, as a common man, want to go to the theater and watch a film that I love to watch. I want to take away something. I want to get my money's worth. Different types of people, you know. So how does it matter what technology we use in the background? How do we do that and all that? So what I am trying to do today is that this is a simple presentation. It's nothing complicated. But at the same time, I wanted to give, you know, our angle to it. what we at Prasad have been seeing, you know, as this technology evolved to whatever we are today, from whatever it was about 60 years back when we started our companies to where we are today. I'm not going to again go into the history and timeline and all that. As we have seen it, we feel that several things have not changed. Several things remain the same. And that is the approach I wanted to take today as we go into this. Can I have a hand mic? You have one? Hand mic? Okay, now before I move, it's working? Hello? Yeah? Okay. So before I move on, I would like to just have I see some youngsters here. You're all from film learning education background, or you're filmmakers, or just film buffs? I mean, I would just like to, sorry? Oh, okay. Maybe you want to say something about how you have come here as a student or as a film enthusiast, or how? Because I need to, see, it's very easy to get deep into technology or remain on the top and still give some valuable points. So I would like to have an idea about how much to go in or not to go in. That's why I'm asking this question, not for anything else. You come from...
We are students and we are working as an actor.
Okay. But you are not filmmakers as such.
So there are a couple of them. So instead of giving the my suggestion is, overviews are available in plenty all over internet. If you can provide some deep insights about the post-production team, that would be valuable advice for all the people who are even from the backing system.
Yeah.
This is what my suggestion is.
Okay.
You could make the best of the presentation. If somebody has come over here, so the brief definitions and the overviews are available plenty all over the place.
So you want me to talk something that is not there on the net?
Not there on the net. And what valuable inputs you as a company are providing to the budding filmmakers? Or
yeah.
What? Because I don't think there are most of these are...
I understand what you mean. I'll try my best on this. Okay. You will see, some of you will see several things which are irrelevant to your line of work or whatever, but please bear with me while I try to keep it more interesting for you. I'll go a bit deep into all this. If you all know, I mean, at least the elders here know very well that celluloid film was what cinema was in those days. Very sadly and unfortunately today, we don't have those films anymore. And it's all digital. So before I begin, so what has changed from our perspective, from a post-production perspective, or from a you know, common man's perspective, between digital and analog, what has changed? Practically nothing. Nothing has changed, except one very, very important thing. One extremely important thing has changed. You know, As a post-production company, we do not get into analyzing any content that comes to us. For us, it is business. We need to pay salary to our people. So a whole industry depends on us. So we need to provide them a living. So that's fine. But there are several people in the company who have seen so many things as individuals, as professionals. Somehow, the lack of, you know, more original content. The lack of, it's a subjective thing. It's again a very subjective thing. But I have spoken to a lot of people in our company, technicians who work hard to provide all these things and to come up with this. Most of them, even the people who mix music in our studios, don't care about what they do anymore. It's coming to that kind of a stage. Like we had some senior people in the music mixing, in the sound mixing department, who used to come and sit and listen to the music and mix it. You know, that trend is changing now. Even the youngsters today who join us as sound mixing, sound engineers, sound mixing professionals, they are very shallow. You know, like when it was a Mukesh song or a, you know, a Kalyan Jiyananji's music or whatever it is, or Ilayaraja music down south, the listening as you mix your, do your job, the level with which you do it, you know, the passion with which you approach it, is kind of different today. I'm not saying it's not there or whatever. It's totally different. Because everything has come to a small 6x6 cubicle or a keyboard or whatever. Back in Chennai, in our studios, if you look at it, we still have one theater that we are holding on to. Not everybody can afford to hold on to, but we are holding on to it. It's what we call a 70mm theater, which we built out of the money we made in Ek Dooje Ke Liye when it became a huge hit. That was the only recording studio in the whole of Asia which could hold so many artists and do a live recording of a complete orchestra. And that's how people used to mix the sound, you know, I mean, record the sound, you know that. We couldn't maintain it because nobody wanted to do anything in that huge recording theater anymore. It's the largest in Asia. Larger than that is only found in one place in Russia. But we still hold on to it. There is no revenue out of it, but we still hold on to it. And we do a small music mixing, in sound mixing in that theater.
It's a live studio,
sir.
It's a live studio.
Sorry?
Live studio. It's a live studio.
Yes, not anymore, but. Not anymore, because you can't keep those kind of equipment anymore without work. Why I'm trying to tell this is that whether we capture in film or celluloid film or in digital, the concept remains the same. When students come to our college to study, they ask us, sir, for cinematography, what cameras do you use to teach us? What software do you use to teach us? You know, I am the first face for them. When they come in with their parents, I am the first one to meet them and speak to them before they decide to join the college. That's a very interesting experience I've had for the past 10 years, speaking to the parents and to the students. How does it matter what camera we use or what software we use? You are here to teach the art and... we are here to teach the art and craft of cinematography, of filmmaking. Not to teach a camera manual to you. That's available in a book form and that's available in the camera itself these days. Just need to press buttons and you get to know how a camera works. Is that what is important? Tomorrow that camera will not be there. Just 6 months down the line, that camera is not going to be there. Some other model is going to come. So again, you are going to go through all these manuals. That's not the point. You have to learn the concept of cinematography, the art of it, the craft of it. And then anybody gives you any camera to work with, you will be comfortable with it. The concept of a DOP. Unfortunately, that is still catching on here. It's not so good as what happens elsewhere in the world. A DOP might never touch the camera. You will have a whole load of cinematographers doing it. So this is the kind of explanations we give to them, and we try to tell them, we have the best of cameras, yes, don't even ask about it. Don't even ask about it, but concentrate on something else, the art and craft, so that you can go out and deliver content which people want to watch. People will come to the theaters to watch, or people will watch in the television or in the mobile also, and pay for it so that an industry can survive. All the theaters going blank, including our theater complex in Hyderabad, you know, the occupancy is so low most of the times. One big film comes and the collection goes up and then again we struggle. That is the way the regional industries are. I wouldn't know about how it happens in the Marathi film industry or the Hindi film industry in Bombay, but I know how it happens down south for Hindi films also. So this is the situation today. So what is important is not all this, how it all happens and all that, but the content, the original content. When we talk about a celluloid film, the process negative, the telecine, offline, edit, cutlist, I can go on into the workflow and try to give you more details into it. But one element here is most important to us. I think I'll bring the whole lot on. It's easier that way. Okay. So one thing is extremely important to us is that we miss the people who did all this in those days. You know, our own technicians, we had about, you know, hundreds of them working on film. You know, no holidays for them, no festivals for them, because festival is film release. So how does it matter now, what equipment you have or what not you don't have? It is the people that was more important to us at that stage. Right? So the film laboratory, when we talk about the laboratory, we talk about equipment, we talk about technology. Today we talk about technology. Who told that technology was non-existent in those days? In fact, it was even more higher, I would say, because you had to discover everything. Today, we are only building on what has already been discovered, step by step. But in those early days, we had to really discover everything. Like when we brought in the film processing equipment and the printing equipment, we had so much problem. Prasad Lab was started by accident. The equipment was imported by a company called AVM Studios in South, in Chennai, who wanted to set up a film laboratory. And then when they saw the whole complexity, they didn't want to do it. So they called Mr. L.V. Prasad and asked whether he would like to take over and do the lab. Hesitantly, we stepped in, and we had no reason to turn back and look at how it all went. It all went fine, but it couldn't have happened without inspired people. Technology is the easiest thing to build today. Technology in any post-production studio is the easiest thing to bring in. I mean, you spend money, you buy a software, you buy a computer, and everything is done. But then, where are the great people to work on it? Believe me, we have a serious short supply. You will understand when I go a little bit inside it, I will tell you that angle. There is a serious short supply of good people. There is a serious short supply. Same as any other education line, like engineering or whatever, where newspapers do surveys and say that 65 to 75% of the people who come out are unemployable. Sorry, that is the same situation here also in the creative industry. So having done this in the past, what we now do today is that we have simply replaced the whole thing with a digital camera. That's about it. Nothing else has changed. It is just that we have stopped employing about 300, 400 people. That's the only thing we have done. And we have got one or two people here in the process to handle your cameras and the data management. Whatever we used to do in the laboratory is now all digital image processing and the handling of digital data. Everything else has now gone. So with digital, there are a lot of advantages and a few disadvantages. It depends on which angle you look at it from. So we do all the thing that the lab did in the digital domain itself very simply today. Right? And then we move on to the editing and the offline, all these things. This, some of you might understand. I don't think we should really go into the details of it, because it's, again, like I told you, irrelevant, and we have more interesting things to talk about. We used to do all these graphics in those days also. It's nothing new. Please understand. The only thing is that we are doing in digital. But I don't know, again, about the Hindi films, because the South Indian films had a lot of mythological stories in it. So by virtue of that particular thing, we have done a lot of visual effects down south, particularly in Tamil and Telugu films, and a little bit in the Kannada films also. Far too much. I will show you some of those clips today, which will, and let's see that for the sake of, you know, nostalgia, and again, trace back one critical element missing in that to what we do today. So we do the computer graphics as the editing is going on and all that. And we do various new things like, you know, optical, visual effects, your titles, trailers, promos, everything keeps happening parallelly. And then finally, we do something called as a conform of the editing and all that. And we give an output very simply to a digital multi-format. This multi-format is what will go to the cinema theater, your standard definition or high definition television, your new media, streaming, Blu-ray, everything, including the pirates. Right now, that continues to be a serious problem. Okay, we continue to do that. I mean, not wantonly, but then it happens. There's no way of stopping it. By the way, there's so many seniors and younger ones here. Could somebody tell me also about, I keep asking this, what is the best way to stop piracy? I mean, is there a solution at all? Your points would, you know, make it more interesting. Anybody? It can be anything. Any suggestions on how this piracy can be controlled? Because it's ruining the entire industry as we see it today. Sorry, sir? Okay. Exactly. See, we have done so much in technology to try and stop this piracy. It's impossible. You do a watermark, you do this, you do that, you go with the whole police force to the theater and, you know, do whatever you want. Nothing is going to change. Nothing ever is going to change. Piracy cannot be controlled unless we stop seeing it. People are buying it in hordes, so I mean, there's no way. The poor thing, those pirates also have to make a living. Come on, they are human beings also, ultimately. Why should we go and blame them when we want to watch it? They're actually doing a good job. That's how I look at it. Okay, so that's how it happens. And earlier, what used to happen was, when this was all in film, we used to bring the data, we used to bring the content into a digital form to do all these portions, and the theaters were still projecting film prints. So we had to get something called as a film recorder. Again, it's like a camera. The concept is like a camera, which means that the digital image was put back to celluloid film, and then it goes to the labs, and then we used to make prints and send it out. Today, this process is also not there, so we are able to go directly from the digital post-production area to the multi-formats of whatever is required. I think I'd just like to stop here before we go on. Any pointers, any questions, any suggestions to as we move along? Because the next thing is going to go into the digital domain immediately, and we talk about a few, again, not technologies, but a few interesting things that are either missed out or not missed out. We have to decide that. That's the way I'm going to talk today. I'm not going to talk about the process flow in detail and all that, like I told earlier. So any pointers, any questions, any suggestions as we move along? Any other things that you would like to give us an input so that, you know, I can include that and talk.
Yeah, I want to ask you something, sir. I'm just about to learn cinematography. And hi, sir. Firstly, thank you for being here. I've traveled all the way from Pune just to attend this workshop because I've heard so much about your... Yeah, I'm from Pune just for this workshop because I've heard so much about Prasad Labs that they're the best. Okay, I just wanted to ask you a quick and simple question. When, as a production house, as a filmmaker, I'm filming a web series or let's say a mainstream Bollywood film, that's what I'm working on this year, people give me a lot of names for cameras, you know. Cameras, because the resolution and the quality, the output should be of a good quality to see it on the big screen. So I get these names, you know, Red Epic, Red Dragon, Arri Alexia, XT. Now, in today's day and age, we all have a vision and we want to put it into a movie or into a cinema, into a piece of work, right? And not everybody wants to foot in bills because of Arri Alexia XT, because, I mean, not everybody's supported by financiers, investors, or sponsors. So the most intelligent way of shooting a movie, a mainstream Bollywood movie with known actors, at the least budget, you know, so that the quality and the output is good enough to be seen on the big screen in PVR, in theaters. Would you please disclose us the secret, the trick? What would it be, which camera to use, and how can it be digitized in the lab to give us that effect at a minimum cost?
So to put it in a nutshell, you are trying to ask me that what is the most economical way of making a high-quality film? Am I right?
Yes.
Yeah. No. That's the way it is. That's my approach. You know, I try to simplify things. I don't understand too much complications, by the way. Thank you. I'm a documentary filmmaker myself, and I do little things, you know. I take my DSLR and I go and shoot, strictly believing that the work that I do is more important than all the technologies that surrounds me. But technology is important, yes. Digital cameras are very expensive. There is no question about it. They are horribly more expensive than the old film cameras. We all know that. And you cannot avoid that particular area. Like, the only thing makers anyway don't invest in cameras. They actually hire it out, they do their work, and they go ahead. So fortunately for those kind of people who want high-end cameras and all that, you still get them at a reasonable hiring rate. I mean, you can negotiate on package deals and still get it. So that aspect is taken care by maybe, your production crew would definitely look at that and still give you a thing. But what camera to use is something that we should definitely, I cannot recommend any cameras here. But what I would like to recommend here, think about here is that it's a very interesting area to deviate now. As much as we all know that film cameras have gone out of fashion and it's all digital cameras today, very strangely, some productions back in Hollywood in the past few years, including as early as last year, have been shooting on film, celluloid film, and not just 35mm film, they are shooting on 70mm film. And why would they do that? Because they believe that film is a beautiful archival medium. You know, the kind of detail, beauty, the grain structure, whatever, you know, so much more in it. They believe it's still, you know, film is film. But it's not digital versus film, because digital is definitely, you know, equal and if not more than film in several ways. So let's not get into that debate. But how those guys think about it, we'll have to understand here. They shoot on, while we are talking about cameras, they shoot on film knowing fully well that the future is uncertain. We don't know what the future is. Nobody knows. Whether it's a Hollywood post-production unit or an Indian post-production company, none of us know the future. We can only talk and talk about it, but none of us know how the future will come out. Why is that? See, you will have to see here. I told you about the standard definition. Television, you all know, was in vogue about 10 years back, or till about 5 years back, or whatever. Today, nobody knows what is it, whereas it's all high-definition cameras. Right? Theaters today or projecting on a resolution called 2K predominantly. Very, very few of them in India are 4K. A few in Bombay, a few in the major metros, maybe a few of them, because it's very expensive. 4K projection is still, you know, not that much as 2K projection. Now, imagine you go for a camera, today digital camera, that has a resolution of, say, 2K. Or 5 years back, you shot a film on 2K resolution. Today, what has happened? There are televisions which are ultra-high definition, which means it's close to 4K or 4K. There are theaters which are in 4K. So what happens to that content that you have already shot in a lower resolution camera? It cannot be blown up. You can't do anything with it. So you are struck with that. What happens to all the people who went digital when standard definition television was there? We converted a lot of films from tape to film in those days. Tape was at a, you know, very low resolution then. So they have gone and shot an entire film at that resolution. What do they do with it today when you have high definition televisions? Film has never been like that, will never be like that. Why? Because the amount of information, details and so many other factors that can be held in a small bit of film is unmatched across time. Across time, whichever way you go, backward or forward or anything. Some years back, what happened when standard definition televisions were there, all the television channels like Zee, Star, Sun, all these guys came to us and they wanted the film to be converted to that standard definition output. We did that and gave it to them. Later, the same guys came with the same negatives. The same film negative shot in those days. They came back to us with it and said they wanted a high definition transfer now, digital transfer. So we provided that. Very luckily for so many of us, those guys still retain those negatives somewhere. We don't know how, what, and all, but it is there somewhere. So when tomorrow, when your television goes ultra high definition, it's good for us. We are in need of more business. But still, when it goes to ultra high definition, they still come back to us with the negatives and say, sir, we want ultra UHD transfer now. So we do that also, right? So what happens with all these cameras that we get struck today is that, is it across time? Does it move across time? We don't know.
Are they future-proof or not?
Definitely they are not future-proof.
What is the solution like?
Definitely not future-proof. You are talking about today. How do I make a film today? Yeah. That's about it. Go for the cheapest service provider. Don't compromise on the cameras. Go for the best technology as available today. Because that is a mistake we all make. We go for low resolution cameras or low quality cameras and we don't get the good output out of it. Go for the best of technology that is available today. Yes, it is expensive, but you have to do it. You don't have an option, right? But at the same time, work out a proper deal with them. That's about it. So to a simple question, I tried explaining it in a larger area, but then came back to the simple point of you don't have an option, you have to spend money. Right? Ultimately, that's where it comes to. We don't really make money these days. I mean, that's the truth. Digital technology has taken the life out of so many of the studios. So we all look at other areas. We will look at it a little later. What we do today, I'll tell you what we do today. This is not very interesting these days for us as a post-production company. And also the post-production industry is kind of split up. In those days, somebody comes to a post-production company, they will do everything from film processing till the final print output. You know, as a package. Not as a package, they want to do it that way. They are comfortable with AdLabs or Prasad or Gemini or whatever, and they will do it that way. But today it doesn't happen that way. Nobody cares about what we do, what equipment we have, how we do it and all. The simple thing they ask is the money that is involved. What cost can you provide for this particular service? Yes.
And within this framework, what budding filmmaker would do to cut the cost? From the people like you?
They cannot cut the cost. See, for two things. First and foremost, when you start a production and when you do your shooting, your stars have already taken all the money you have. That is the reality. There is nothing else left when they come to us. So they come and tell us, boss, we have about 5 lakhs to finish the film. Can you guys do it or not? If Prasad says no, there are so many small timers with a computer in their house who will do it and give it to them. They need to come to us only for this mastering, which is hardly of interest to us. Right? So there is nothing like we can, the industry has changed. The trend is different today. It's totally different. In spite of all this, there are a few filmmakers who still understand the value of good films, good quality content, the best way of doing it, and they want to do it that way. They still come to people like us to do. We are happy with that. We are happy with that percentage of business, as I call it. They're happy with that. The small timers, we cannot control. They will go where they can get the best for their money till they realize something else. And by then, it may be too late. There may not be a big service provider or there may not be anybody who really wants to do it in the good old way. Right? I hope I didn't confuse you there. Okay. Yes, at a huge cost, as in loss of quality. Cost means I don't mean money. I mean, what can you do? If you have worked with a simple Photoshop, you know that a small image, if you stretch it, what happens? So everything else that is put on it is just, you know, cosmetic. Gloss, makeup. That's how it works. So So if you are stuck in HD, you are stuck in HD. You don't have an option unless you have the content in film as a film negative, as a negative. That is the reason why the Hollywood films of big budgets do their, they shoot in film and digitize it and keep the film safe. The rest happens in digital only, till the end, till it comes to the theater and all. The film is not touched at all. It is safeguarded and preserved in the perfect way. The second part of my presentation talks about it. Then probably I can answer your question. Okay, so here we move on. And so I have made it clear that the post-production industry is not...
What we will do is let him have his lecture on. At the end, we will go for Q&A. I think he is breaking his flow also. We should not. Okay?
Sorry, that was my mistake because I asked for your inputs. So I'll change the way now. Sure, sir, I'll change the way accordingly now. All right. So what we used to do in those days was that you had the negative and you used to put it through the filters and you used to get a printout of it. As simple as that. Today what happens is that we have the same thing which comes to us as a raw image from a high-quality digital camera, high-end digital camera, and we still have an image which is like a storehouse or a powerhouse of information. That's raw data. That's what we call as a raw format. After that, we work on it, we do the image processing, and we come out. So essentially, the concept remains the same. Right? Only thing is that in those days, what used to happen was, when we go to the film laboratory, people just used to, they could just do with the primary colors, the correction. So when you correct this frame, you get a frame which is flat in terms of everything. Not flat in terms of, in terms of overall colors. Like if I adjust the blue here, everywhere the blue will get adjusted. If I adjust the red, the entire image will get adjusted and all those things. This again was an art. The cinematographer used to sit with our analyze, the color analyzer, the color correcting person in those days, in front of a machine called the color analyzer. There's so many makes and models in it, it didn't matter. What mattered was the person sitting on the analyzer and the cinematographer. Right? We never cared about anything else. So when they do that, we still used to come out with great films. I mean, superb films. Nobody really bothered about all these fine points. Why? Because the content held them. Today what is happening is that the gimmick is what is made to hold people, bring them. You need to have a trailer with some kind of song in it, running all over the television to attract the people to the theaters or to watch your film. People didn't have to do it in those days. They knew very well that the content is good, it will work. If the content is not good, it's going to go out of the theaters. So they were under pressure to provide more and more and more. Not that all the films made were great also. Can we have the lights off for a few minutes? Okay, so what is happening is that, we'll come to this frame and I'll tell you. Yeah, so in the olden days when we used to do the post, we couldn't control fine things like the eyes here, you know, or the piece of small bit of jewelry here or anything like that. You cannot control it, its color is fixed. Today, we have methods of changing everything the way we want. Along with it comes the question of why do that? If you had properly done it when you wanted to shoot, and if you had planned it well, you don't need to change it. But still, I mean, there are other things. It's not just changing the color or anything. It's become an art. Using the digital technologies is also an art. It's becoming like, the art is not dead. The art is still there. But how we use it. Today what is happening is that you do a mistake when you are shooting and they say, boss, we'll go to the post-production studio and set it right. But while shooting, it shouldn't happen. The room for compromise with digital is being exploited. Digital technology is not at fault. Again, it is the people who are at fault. Please understand that. The digital technologies, if exploited to the fullest extent, can provide content which is far superior to the ones that we provide today. Far, far superior than what we provide today. But unfortunately, the digital medium is being used as a comfort zone to cover up for various things, to do anything you want, to adjust, compromise, all those things. See, today with digital grading, for example, when the colorist, that's a very important job and you don't get people to do it. He's an expert on color. He's an expert on the physics, the science, the art of color. And they are all over the place. They are all over the place across the country. But very few know really what they are doing. Right? If you look at this frame, for example, you will see multiple lights of different, colors, what we call as color temperatures. You have the warm color here, the yellow ones. Then you probably have a daylight kind of an effect here. And then you have the lamp kind of a lamp effect here and all that. So this was from a film made some years back. The cinematographer, Mr. David McDonald, it's a Hindi film. He sat with a colorist who still lives and works in Bombay. He's from Canada, a gentleman called Ken Metzger. And he wouldn't want to leave India. He didn't want to leave India. He married an Indian and he lives here because he loves India and the art and the culture scenario here so much. He enjoys himself. So he enjoyed working on this project. And they spent so much time in fine-tuning each and every shot and exploiting the digital medium. They literally exploited this medium and they brought out, that film is like a piece of art in some places. Again, subjective, but yes, it was like a piece of art in several films. I mean, look at this. So many things, you can't even describe it. You can't even understand the complexity of the whole thing. But they have brought it for your enhancement, which was not possible with the analog technologies. Like this one, again. Everything is controlled to focus onto the gentleman walking in the middle, going inside that. The art of composition, lighting, everything plays there. The digital technologies have been exploited to the full level here also. Simple things, we'll go into another very important aspect of digital color grading and its advantages over analog grading and how it can be used or not used. We wouldn't say misused or anything like that because it's a creative process. This is what we call as a raw scan that comes out of the camera. This was shot on high-end cameras. The image is not high resolution because I have shown it like that for our use. See, this is what we normally do as a base grade. So we have brought the general, the color temperatures and the mood of the entire shot into this particular base grade. This is the foundation on which we start working now, the first level. We adjust all the names that we didn't know before, saturation, luminance curve, fine-tuning and all those things. Here what's happening is that you can see there are several things that are not required. For example, the lights there is affecting the shot. The focus was supposed to have been on the lawns here. So we don't want that to dominate and take away your attention as you as a spectator watch this film. So they have lowered the top there when they adjusted the fine-tuning of the grade. Okay? And then what happens is that still it's taking too much attention. So they have put a mask to control it only on the top. And then the tree, if you look at it, it's in the middle, it's an important element in the shot, but it cannot dominate again, and it's too dark. So what they have done is they have kind of blocked it out so that it merges a little bit into the darkness more. the background light source now. It's a, the setting is colonial, so you need to have that kind of an effect in it, the yellow bulbs and stuff like that and all. So they have done that in the next shot, next step. And the background light source has been adjusted overall. So you can see this is a raw scan, and this was the one you saw in the theater. For the normal eye, it can just be that you have adjusted some colors and black darkened the whole thing. But that's not true. There is so much more that has gone into it without the conscious mind able to see whatever it is. Similarly here also, if you look at it, the raw scan, you can see that the overall thing is primarily graded. And here what has happened is that this as important as it is in the shot, because this is telling you what kind of a room he is living, what kind of conditions are there, what kind of a setting it is there. So much, every piece of this frame should talk for them. This is something, I'm not telling this. This I discussed with the cinematographer, and in his own words, I understood this happened about 10 years back, if my memory is right. I still remember the whole thing like yesterday because he was so passionate about the whole thing. So he didn't want this to dominate. So what he did was he controlled it and brought it down separately. Now, all this wouldn't have been possible with the analog technologies. You have to have the digital technology to do all these beautiful things. And the window on top. You know, it's obviously shot in a studio, and they shot with the proper light there so that they can control later to the level that they want when they see the frame in the screen. So now they have brought down that light to make it look like a night, okay? And the lamp behind has been adjusted as required. And the frame has been darkened overall. Now, in all this that we did, we forgot about the main character. This is the story. This is where it's all happening, not in the whole thing. They only provide a support role there. So what they did was, they adjusted that area and brought him out and created a kind of a vignette effect to reduce the overall dominance. So the eye, when it watches, it gives the mood of the thing. The storytelling process, you have to look at it from that. The storytelling process, how do you create the mood in the audience and hold them, transport them to that situation there. And the fine-tuning finally, and the final grade. So you can see how it was shot. The raw scan obviously had all this information in it so that they can be brought out or lowered. That is the importance of having the best camera possible and shooting in good with good sensors and the best of technology available today. So that like a film negative, you can go inside and bring out some information that is stored but not depicted in your initial look. Only if the information is available in the image, it can be brought out. We cannot bring out something that is not there. We can only again create and make it look awkward. So if the shooting process happens with that proper knowledge, understanding of the medium, then the advantages of digital technology is enormous. Yeah, before we move on to, I'm sorry, sir, I would like to again take a break here. Because I have planned it that way, so I'm trying to reduce it now. Can we have the lights on, please? So before we move on to the VFX, now, when I say VFX, again, I think I should talk about VFX when I show you those samples. Can we have the lights on, please? Any other suggestions, points here that I would like to, that I can clarify before we move along? So now we have kind of established that analog technologies had a lot of advantages, a lot of beauty to it, but when digital came, we discovered the limitations of the analog technology, and we started using the digital technologies, but whether we have really exploited it or not is a question that none of us can answer. Each man has his own answer. We don't want to get into that now. Though when we get opinions, I would love to really get your opinions on whatever is happening today. That will help me, you know, go ahead and talk in the future. So that's where we stand now. But one point that has always stayed throughout, whether it was film or whether it is digital, old films, new films, is that the people who made all this are the key ones. Not the piece of equipment, not the software, not the piece of hardware. That has to happen. That has to be there. That's taken for granted. But the people who made this remain the most important people in this aspect. We'll see a little bit more on how we can... This is not a VFX session. We are not going to discuss about how we shot, how we did, and all those complexities and all. Today, it's all pretty much easy because we all know people shoot with green mats, blue mats, whatever, you know, things, and they do anything you want. So whatever you don't understand is digital. They have done some graphics on it. It has come to that level today. But what is important here is a few things that we, as a pioneer in VFX, we were the first ones to, along with Prime Focus, maybe a little bit this side, that side, were the first companies to bring digital visual effects to the Indian film scenario. Till such time, people had to go abroad to get it done. I will show one. This will be a bit slow. You will have to put up with me because, what is this? I'm sorry. So, maybe this light you can just switch off. Okay, this particular shot, this happens all the time in Indian cinema. Actually, and before we move, I would like to make it clear that the visual effects that we do in Indian films, I'm sorry, I don't use the word Bollywood films. I use Indian films. I'm a pretty bit, frustrated with that word. I don't want to get into that diversion right now. If anybody is interested in why I am that way, we can talk later. I don't use the word Bollywood, Mollywood, Collywood, you know, A to Z wood and all that. So what happens here is that it's a song sequence, complicated, made more complicated because the camera is moving into the shot. So how do you get this done? Now is that the technology is all available. It's pretty much simple. You shoot the lady dancing in green mats, blue mats, whatever you want. And since the camera is moving, we have to have something called as a motion controlled rig. That's a computer controlled rig that will move in and then come back again, move in n number of times. It will repeat the same action and also control the camera's lens, focus and all in the same way, precise way. It's frame perfect. It cannot be, even one frame cannot be out of sync. So that is how these shots are taken. So one thing is striking here. What is the most complicated thing in this shot? Anybody? Any suggestions?
I think aligning all the separate chroma shots.
Yes.
Normal and natural.
Yes, excellent. Excellent, that's one thing. Any other points? No? I mean, we forgot the poor lady who has to do it 100 times. In all the technical paraphernalia that surrounds us, we forgot the hardship that he has to undergo, she has to undergo. It's not easy doing this. Because, see, it's easy for us to tell, madam, that didn't come all right, you have to do one more shot. For what? For one movement. So imagine she has to go ahead and do this whole thing so many times, move here and there, and have the same kind of a dance flow, whatever it is. I mean, that is another complexity. But look at that. She has to do all that. And then our guys use all the software and the keying techniques, tools available, part of the system, to just do it in a jiffy. Remove the background, bring them all together, ensure that the timing is there. Okay, now this timing looks similar, so slightly adjusted by a bit of, maybe a fraction of a second or whatever to make it look different and move in a different way. The real hard work in this is done by the artist, not by the guy sitting in the computer. Another similar thing is this particular shot in a Rajini film of some years back. Why I'm showing the older films is, and not the newer ones is a very important point. Technology has constantly evolved, making things easier for us. But when we did these films in the early stages, all of us in India were learning how to do this. Yes, we had to learn. It's not that things dropped on us and we were pioneers, so we know everything. No, we knew nothing. We had to learn as we went along. This shot, for example, looks pretty much simple. Nothing great about it. It's just a fight and everybody is supposed to fall down. But then how did we do it? It's impossible to roll that kind of a drum around and shoot. I mean, somebody is going to get hurt very badly. So what we did was we shot without the drum. Now this again, we can call it as a digital effects, VFX, whatever you want, you can use complicated names. But how do you do this? How do you do this? It's a spot decision made by these guys, the visual effects supervisors, from Prasad, from their side. They try it first. They tried it, really, and they were very scared. First itself, sir, it's not possible. So we then discuss and decide how to do it. This was the best way that we could work out. No drum, nothing. We will add the drum later. So he went ahead and did the entire thing. Now comes a more difficult part. First, look at the star. It's impossible to move freely the way you would have moved with a heavy weight in your hand. I mean, it's, we all know that. It's like this, whereas you move like this. It doesn't work that way. It has to look realistic. Somebody is going to add a weight onto my hand and make it move the way it should move. So I need to express, I need to, you know, kind of, whatever, my movements and the muscular things and all should be that way. He has to realize and do that. One problem in that. The second thing is all these poor guys getting thumped all around. Now they need to fall at the exact time. It's not that you fall when his hand is there. You have to anticipate the drum is coming a bit of a few fractions of second behind. So when his hand is there, if you fall, then you have done a mistake. So it has to come like that. So all these movements have to be controlled. And that has to be controlled by a person sitting on top, watching it from a top angle, who will tell them who went wrong while the shooting was going on. See, we are talking about a few crores of payment being made to the star here. And if I have to call him on one more day, then we are losing money. So you just have to do it once and you have to do it perfectly. So again, the person who coordinated this whole shot is the most important person in this. Then this shot comes to our company. So again, nobody talks about, I don't talk about software and hardware again. I talk about the guys who actually went out, bought a drum like that, and one of them started swinging it, with a few of them recording it, and understanding its dynamics, the movements of it, how it will work. It's not just that you create one thing in 3D, rotate it in any way, and put it all around and roll it. There's a lot of hard work in it. So the human element is not gone. It is there. What is gone is a lack of understanding of the importance of that human brain. In our own studio, many people have just become slaves of softwares, which is the worst thing that can happen to the beautiful medium of digital technologies. You need to know how to exploit it. One more visual effects before we move on to the next thing. I don't want to be overdoing it, but one small thing. This was the first Krish, not the recent one. When we worked on the first Krish, we had some, A to Z were problems for us. We didn't know anything as a company, as an industry. We're all struggling at that time. We had foreigners who came and helped us in the visual effects, supervision, action, everything, but then we were struggling. But we delivered whatever was possible in the best possible way. So we went ahead and got several awards for this, including the Indian National Award and all that. This shot got the Shot of the Year Award and a few submissions. So you have the hero going through the gap between the cabin and the container. Simple stuff. It happens all the time in Indian films today. But in those far-off days, we had a bit of issue here because the camera had to go with him. So it was not one person who had to move between the moving truck. It was two people. The second person obviously has to have the whole bit of equipment on him. Again, we made a simple decision of doing without the container. The decision was the simplest to make, finally, when we look back after 10 years or whatever. But on that day when this happened, we'll just see how we attempted it first. That is a cameraman who went first to check it out. Now he has got more confidence, so he wants to do it again with the equipment. And there he goes. See what happens now. He got hurt badly. The equipment got damaged. So luckily, nothing went wrong. And this is without the star going through. So the original shot, this is just a rehearsal. So finally, we had to do like, there you see his leg getting hurt. Because somebody made a mistake in pulling the rope. You know, the rope was a bit too low. The wires were a bit too low. Even though we were doing it with, experienced people, you can still have the thing happening. So all this happened when we were doing this, and the team there didn't know how to shoot it. So we had to go on a con call with the Chennai guys who were going to do the visual effects shot as to how to shoot this plate. So after a little bit of deliberation, because this was happening in Singapore, and there is no way that we can ask them, we will come tomorrow and do and all. We have taken the time today, so you guys better finish it immediately, within the prescribed time. And over and above that, they have all these safety standards, mandatory things and all that. So we had to go through all those things and wait there. So we had about 10 minutes all to decide on how to go about it. And that's how we took the decision of not shooting with the container. We told them to just go ahead and shoot without the container. We will add the container, but make sure that the cameraman and the actor remain in this area because the truck has to move. They come a little bit more or the truck moves a bit faster or whatever, then the shot cannot be done. Whatever you may have, you can't do it. So we had to do it precisely. So again, a clear exhibition of the human brain and mind at work here. We never talked about technology there, the software that we will use back here and all that. Nothing was discussed except the shot. This is the kind of thing that we do most of the time these days when we have to shoot in complicated locations, crowded locations. So it's all computer-generated models, 3D models, and then we do the live action into it. We come back to the studio and shoot the live action portions and bring them all one on top of each other. It's all layers that are being, one after the other, we are trying to show you how we shot the crowd separately, added more people, added the litter, the garbage, everything. This was all done in the studios. Because this was a very crowded location, we can't do it. It's a real location. What we had to do was the team had to spend a lot of time in studying that place. A lot of time means a few hours because 2 to 3 days is all we get to do these kind of things. Okay, so they went with a team of photographers, some guys sketching, video, all those things, observations, and they created this entire thing to do. This is something that happens today, which couldn't have been done without the digital technologies. One more thing, and then we move out of this VFX and we go off to something else. But this again is another interesting subject. This is not the film. That's not the film. It's just that they have put the... Okay. Now, this is a South Indian film. The first thing was that this film was scheduled to release on one Friday, And the previous week, the director feels that it's not working out. I need one more song. So as always, they come up with the, in the last minute. And here starts the challenge of this whole thing. First, he says that the song, as you know, the songs in our films are all, you know, 4 minutes, 5 minutes. It's not an easy thing to do. He wanted it as a single shot. A single shot. It should show no cuts in the middle. Okay, we can't say yes or no. We just have to absorb and we have to work out something. There's no option for us. The second thing is that the hero will come in something about anything between 5 to 10 times as, you know, versions, avatars, whatever, in the song. And this heroine would come about 8 to 10 times. And the shot has to be seamless, one continuous thing. Now, how do we do that? So what we did was, and all this in about 2 to 3 days' time. So the first decision we made was that we will move the post-production team to the location. We can't shoot, come back, make mistakes, come back and reshoot and all, not possible. So we moved the post-production team to composite there itself. Do the chroma keying, do the compositing, whatever has to be done there itself. I've just put together about 10 layers, but there is much more in it. If you look at how we do it, is that this again is a computer-controlled rig, a motion-controlled rig. So you can see the camera is moving at one particular thing, and you can see it coming back, see? And then you add the second one. See, the camera is moving in the same way. It has to come back in the same way. So on and on and on it went. Till finally, we brought them all together. Yes, 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 yes. Yes. See, now this is the same person doing all this. This happens all the time in our films. Nothing great about it. But the only thing is, when we shoot, there's a lot of planning that has to happen. For example, now, one person moving in the floor cannot overlap. So the guys have to do a kind of path for each role, each avatar to come and do his job and go. Right? The timing of that has to be perfect. So that has to be planned. So that they don't step on each other when the shot is finally merged. Okay, so now what happens is that how do we make it as a single shot, the whole song? So they had to plan everything. Like, for example, the camera goes from this side and then comes back here. This is a 360-degree set we created. Otherwise, such a shot cannot be done. So the camera stops here, and the next shot would have seamlessly started from there. See, it comes here. The one would have overlapped and moved so that the same girl would be doing something else in the next shot, or somebody else would have come in there. And then we kept on moving around and round and round till that entire song was done. So here, if you look at it again, what is the most important thing is the patience and the planning of the guys in the field. Nothing else matters here. Before we move on with this one, I have a small... Okay. I think it's already 4:40, so for want of time, I will avoid that. But in those days, when all these visual effects were done, how did it happen? It was purely, again, because of the people. I think it's better to see it. Doesn't matter, it's just about 2 minutes. Just give me a second. Sorry, I'll just take a couple of minutes to look at it. I'm sorry, you have to see what is there in my system. There's no other option. Okay, I have titled it VFX before CG, how it was done, right? Can we have the lights off? Because it's very low quality footage. Like I told you, the South Indian films had a lot of graphics in those days. So I have just taken a few shots from those films. It has a typical music of those days, but I don't think we can hear it. I'll keep the sound on anyway. But we look at it, and then you will understand where I am coming to. Can we have the lights off, please? Lights. So what time is the next show?
5:30.
5?
5:30.
Okay. Just show you one more before we start talking. Okay, now it's not that we were not doing anything before. We were doing a brilliant job out of it. The audience were loving it. That was a level that was expected in those days, and they were doing a good job out of it. All fine. Look back today, it's not correct. But still, they were still doing it in those days. There's a starting point for our next program, maybe. Next part of the thing. See, this was a shot from that film where you saw the elephants going and knocking down a door. This was the previous shot of that. You can see the... I mean, it's a very confusing kind of a shot. How did they do this? Yeah, I'll close this, switch on the light, and then we'll take the question. Just, I've looped it, you can just see a couple of times and then we'll move forward. Okay? Yes. Yeah, we can have the lights on, please. Sorry. So there were some brilliant things that happened in those days. The unfortunate thing is that these were not documented by anybody properly. That's a serious situation where we have failed in, not only in the cinema line, I'm sure, maybe if there are any historians here, they will know. In several other areas also, we have failed because of improper attention to documentation, creation of documents, history, and all those things. Anyway, that's a large subject. So how this could have been done? Today, it's very simple. Just shoot some elephants somewhere, put them in the water, and repeat them with different timing. Do whatever you want. But in those days, far away, this film was in the 1950s. So how they would have done it? Like, I received several inputs from several people, nothing was satisfactory, I don't know. I don't even know how they would have done this. First, I have to accept that. If anybody has any idea, they could just, you know, throw up some light on the subject. How this such a shot could have been done in those days. Because many people have told so many things, and I have somehow negated everything. So I'm just searching for an answer. Is there any other inputs that comes. Any ideas? Yeah.
It's a top angle shot. If you observe the elephant getting into water at a particular time in the morning,
yeah,
and it's gone and stood on top of a hill and taken a top angle shot of them,
yeah,
taking a swim in the lake,
yeah,
river,
It sounds simple. But then if you look at the shot, it's a river, it's a flowing river, and the elephants go behind layers into infinity, into the horizon practically. So how that could have been done? Well, if you look at the shot, it's technically not possible. If you analyze the shot in detail, it's been clearly told that that was not the way it was done. Yes, there has been something, we don't know what. See, this is what I'm coming to tell you, had some proper documentation been focused on those days also, not that we do it today, spend more time on the making and recording all these things, future generations would have had a lot more to learn from and a lot more subjects to talk about and present about. We are still not doing it. We are just creating makings and all that. But half the makings are just, before, after time. The real kind of things are just not there. Anyway, anybody else? I don't have an answer, so I'm not going to waste time on that. If anybody has, you can tell. Otherwise, we move on to the next one. This was a film called Avayar. I think it was in the 50s. Somebody said that these elephants were all there and they were told to move at the same time. Well, they didn't have cell phones to tell the guys to move. Neither did they have the, walkie-talkies to make the things move. And the elephants wouldn't just come when you tell them to move. You can maybe chase them from there, but there is no clear way that it will enter the water. And that too, all of them at the same time, multiple layers, multiple levels, we don't know. So it could have been a wildlife shot taken from stock, but again, it's not as simple as that. It's not as simple. For those of you who have shot wildlife, you will know how difficult. I mean, animals just don't come and stand and pose for your photographs. So that again is a very tricky thing to talk about. Anyway, let's keep thinking about it. We'll move on to something slightly more different from what we have been talking till now. So we spoke about various things as to record keeping, losing out on information, everything. We know today that all the silent films that have been made in India are lost. There's nothing practically, if I'm right. Maybe sir will be able to throw more light on that. But practically every silent film have been lost. A few are still there. People are struggling to revive it, whatever. Or revived a few of them, restored a few of them and all that. So that is a sad state of affairs. Simply because preservation of anything has never been important, not only to Indians. The same scenario exists in the US also. All the films, silent era films, something like about 60 to 70% of it was lost by them also. It's not that the situation is different anywhere else in the world. So then why preserve at all? First, let's answer that question before we move on. Because if we talk about preservation, we talk about restoration, we talk about something, then why should we preserve it first and foremost? Because we all know that cinema is forever, and we also know that film is forever. Film as a medium is forever. So we have a duty and a responsibility to preserve it, to pass it on to the next generation, whatever, as long as time goes. Celluloid film, this is what has been happening to that medium in all the days that attention has not been paid to it. There are situations where we have opened a can of film for digitization and we have just found a little bit of melted liquid inside, It has been like that also, that bad. Nothing can be done with that. Bad condition where you can see that, they have stuck onto each other and the emulsion has been peeled off. I mean, so many things. All because at that time, when films were made, there was no thought about that it might become useful in future. Nobody really thought about it. We wanted to do something then. People liked it. People all appreciated. I collected money, so that negative is gone. Very few people took care to store those negatives in the right way. Store. It's, preservation is different. They stored it in some way, and they kept it. The rest is all in these kind of conditions. So what has been happening in the recent times is that Somewhere around the year 2007, when the film Jaws, made by Steven Spielberg, was taken by him to see, he experienced a similar situation. Nothing there, all these problems. So that was when a digital restoration movement started everywhere, with people like Martin Scorsese starting something called as a film foundation, where they get money to fund films to get restored, select the films and all those things, And several other people, archives around the world, including our own archives here in India, everybody doing their might to do their best to start locating these precious elements and doing something to preserve them for the future generations. And it's not an easy process. So anyway, so today what we do is we take up film and tape for preparation. Because a negative in that condition cannot be just digitized or restored. We can do nothing about it. So you need, again, the old guys to come back. The film laboratory guys are being called back by us, a few of them at least, to actually work on these films, because they only know how to handle film. For those of you who have handled film, you know that even winding it is an art. There is a technique to it. You can't just take a film reel, wound a film reel and show it like that. It'll all fall down. It's so, it's so tricky. So we had to bring in the film people to come and actually see these films, give them different treatments, repair them. The ones that were cut had to be mended, repaired. So much work had to be done before you can think about digitizing them. It's not that film is taken and digitized. There's a lot of work before that, and you need the film handling specialist in this. And then you digitize it. You put it in a scanner and you run the reel to digitize it. And then you can do some image enhancement on it, the process of restoration. Like some areas, some colors are faded, some patches are there, I touch it up, do this, do that kind of thing. And image enhancement has to be done on that. Simultaneously, somebody has to work on the sound. Because the soundtracks, when a film negative is lost, obviously in those days, for those of you who know, you had a picture negative and you had a sound negative. So a similar fate would have happened to a lesser degree in the sound negative also. So somebody has to restore that and they have to bring it in. Then you need to store all this humongous amount of data that is generated by digitizing. Now, having done this, now all this costs money. Now, who's going to spend that kind of money? Unless they see some kind of meaning in it. So the meaning has to be there. The meaning is that somebody has to access these films, the digitized ones, and somebody has to deliver it to them. And everybody who watches it, everybody who uses those footages have to pay somewhere for it. Otherwise, this whole process can't happen. It's not a cheap one, it's very expensive. So this is the situation that we stand in today. Now, when you say access, delivery, all these things are all fine. But then there are hordes of people who search for it with different names. How do people locate it on your portal, on your server? So we need to create a large amount of metadata. Go shot by shot and say horse is in this shot. So horse is a thing for the metadata. Water, fire, like that. You know, it goes on and on and on. So it's a whole lot of people who work on metadata. Now you know that the cost has become more and more because you have to do more work on it. So unless and otherwise, we talk about monetizing the final content, preserving for the future is going to be an impossible task, practically impossible. Or somebody has to fund it, like the government keeps funding those kind of things. I mean, whose money? It's all our money anyway. So it doesn't matter. But unless people start paying for anything and everything, it's not going to work. So now you have digitized, you have given it to the new channels, you have made a Blu-ray and all that. So what next? You definitely cannot throw back the negative into the garbage dump. You can't do that. You have to again preserve it. You have to again store it in ideal conditions. Why you need to again store the negatives? Because like we discussed earlier, tomorrow we don't know what technology is going to come for viewing. So what happens if somebody comes up with a large, something else, like a whole theater, a digital screen or something like that, something is coming, you need high resolutions. What do you do then? You need the negative. And not only that, the original camera negative, forget the technology and the resolution part. These are precious. It's a piece of history. That film negative is the original camera negative that has been put in the camera by the very hands of some great cinematographer and filmmaker in those days, and you have them luckily in parts today. So you're dealing with a piece of history. It's a relic. It's like a, I mean, any other monument that you discover under the, earth. It's as simple as that. That needs to be preserved now. You can't just throw something like that. It's of historical importance. That is the next step. How we are going to do this. And then we talked about film. Is it only film that we are talking about? It's not the film alone. Everything that goes with the film, your scripts, your production notes, everything has to be preserved. Imagine going to a Hollywood studio today, Universal Studios or wherever, and you are watching a, and you have an experience for half a day, one day, whatever, going through old films and really standing before them and experiencing it and all that. How did all that happen? We missed out on all those things here in India. Imagine the Chandralekha set, there we had the drum dance. Even if one drum had been preserved, it would have been possible to, you know, create an experience out of it for present-day generations. It would have made more money because you have a selfie crowd today. You want to take selfies with everything. So imagine each drum everywhere. Look at the amount of money you can collect by just entry fees into those parks. So, I mean, we have lost out on so many things. We will continue to lose out because even today, these things are not being attended to. Why? Because we are preoccupied with releasing a film, making money and getting out. And mind you, that film is not even going to run for 1 month to give you a breather time. 3 shows, that's all. By then you have to make your money and get out. If you are not smart, then you have lost that. So where is the question of saving so many things? Very few people do it. But it's a whole business altogether that can be in our hands. And then again, we have been talking about cinema because it's a film festival. But then is it only cinema that we are talking about? No, there is so much more. What about all these other things? The industrial films that have been made, the war films that have been made, everything. They all have a huge possibility. I mean, every film you see, every documentary that you see in National Geographic or Discovery has some footage from the past. There is no way you can create such content for such channels without history, historical. So all this, they have to be kind of taken up, identified first, located. We don't even know where many of them are there. So the tasks start from there. It's not as simple as just taking from some cupboard and doing something with it. We don't even know where it is all about. So this is the situation. And the saddest part and the most tricky part here is that nobody cares about this. And this is what is typically called the orphan films. Because there is no possibility for making fast money with that. So this is, again, another huge volume of information and content that has been lost and it is being lost. So now, after having spoken for such a long time, I deserve a little bit of publicity for my company. So what are we doing about it? Well, to be honest with you, we are only looking at it as a business. It's not that we are doing charity or anything like that. So what we did was that we invested in a company in Germany that makes scanners. Now, these are not just ordinary scanners. These are archival scanners. Scanners that are invented, patented to scan damaged and defective films. And we also invested in a company in Switzerland, which does a similar thing with the sound side of it. These are the sound digitizing equipment. So it's not about just making thing or making, digitizing. Why we did that was, if you look at any archive anywhere in the world, you will find our film scanners and sound scanners working. And this is just a few of them. That scanner is so good and it's so important to the industry. So that is the reason why we went into it and took over that entire thing. And we have if we continue to do R&D, and it's not exactly a money spinner. There comes the tricky part. This manufacturing of these scanners and selling them is not easy. You will sell maybe one scanner in a year. So that scanner would cost, all things put together, say about 30 crores, 35 crores, whatever it is. But if you are lucky if you sell one scanner. And you know very well, sitting in India, how much that 35 crore means today. Nothing at all. And we still have to continue that because there is no other option other than to go the way we have started. There's no going back now. We have to keep that the technology going. And then we restore it. This, some of the frames, you won't be able to see very clearly, but you can, because of this, see, you see these vertical lines that have been removed in this. This is from a Clint Eastwood film. And then this was another challenge that we faced when we restored a film called How the West Was Won. It was shot on something called as a Cinerama negative, you know, three negatives. So that they used to sit and watch it all around. It was a brief present technology in those. Then it went off for various reasons. But that film is there, so we had to merge them all together to make a single frame, restore it, remove the device. This is from Kabhi Kabhi. Everything had gone in this negative. A lot of Diwali happening there, you know, all kind of sparkles, circles, everything. So we really had to clean it up. And this is a frame from Nayadaur, where you could see the negative had cut over a length. It had just been, something had happened, we don't know what. It had just gone through, somebody had put a scissor the wrong way or the knife the wrong way. And here you can see the scratches and all that. So this was again taken up and restored. This restoration happens frame by frame. You know, we have to digitize it first and then we have to restore it frame by frame. Again, you can see some part has actually kind of congealed or melted, whatever, and we had to do it. So these kind of things, what we do is, the date, the information here is completely gone. There is nothing. So we will go back the previous frame or the next frame and bring these chaps here. Take them from that frame and put them here and adjust in the damaged frame, things like that. So essentially, it's a frame by frame kind of a work. So now in restoration, now can some names of Hollywood classics come? Say anything here? Yeah, I'm through. This is the last thing. Can you name some Hollywood classics?
Gone with the Wind.
Gone with the Wind. Sorry?
Casablanca,
How the West Was Won, Ben-Hur, Ten Commandments, the list goes on and on and on. And we still remember them today. The world remembers. We have worked in all these films. We have restored in India, Prasad, in Chennai, and Hyderabad, and Mumbai. Our team has restored all these films, something like about 500 Hollywood classics have been restored by them. And something like about all of them, about 40 to 50 of them are all Academy Award winning titles and all that. So what can you do about that? Okay, now the important thing is that in Bombay, for example, now in the past, some of our friends have located negatives lying in different areas, being sold in the street, lying somewhere in garages and all that. In case you come across anything like that, you know, maybe probably you should pick it up by paying some money and satisfying that guy and pick it up and maybe you can hand it over to somebody. You don't know what it is there. Like somebody recently discovered something that has been totally lost. Like the first Konkani film ever made, which was totally lost and somebody somewhere located it. And right here in Bombay, it was restored by Film Heritage Foundation. They have taken up that. So people are struggling to do it. When we were talking about this with the director of NFA, also present in Pune Film Festival, one gentleman said that we should send spies into the market to scour the markets and get all these things done. So while it was a very acceptable kind of a point, the fact remains that it's not possible unless public participate in such initiatives. You're walking in the road, you see a songbook, you see something, you see a gramophone record. You may not be a collector, but by just picking it up and maybe handing it over to somebody who is collecting, Because all collectors don't have money. So maybe a little bit like that, if we can do it, you are preserving, again, some parts of history. That's as simple as it gets. And before I say thank you, there's one more thing. Some slides back, I said you have to preserve documentaries, industrial films. In that, I had mentioned a very small thing on home videos. Yes, it's important that we preserve it. Can you just imagine a program that runs in any of these channels, either Discovery or National Geographic or whatever it's called? America's Funniest Videos. They branded first itself, America's. It's not the world's or anything. America's Funniest. Where did it come from? Nobody shot it. It was all home videos. And whoever contributed to that also made money in the bargain. And that's a program that makes money, continues to make money. We all watch it. Whenever you are bored, you sit and watch those films, not only on television, on YouTube also, you sit and watch it. So there are potential and opportunities everywhere in whatever we do. But the only thing is that it has to be preserved. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. I hope I did my best on this. So for want of time, if you have questions, we can maybe... totally up to depending on your time, sir.
Hello. Yeah, thank you very much, Mohan. Thank you. I think it was a very revealing and wonderful. Give a big hand to him. All the way, he has come from Chennai. And he had also a wonderful time in Pune when he is, and we first met. So much so that now I feel that the post-production technology has become a kind of a subject of a study, and many people are... In fact, we are planning now, as we have the MIT school, film school in Pune, we are going to have a course, a master into post-production technology. We're just trying to work on that. And it's silly, I mean, he touched two things, you know, like, for example, the whole revolution, what happened to the whole thing, was marvelously told. Though, because of time restraints and all that, you couldn't get the chroma and so many things. Like, for example, here a wonderful footage of Bahubali, how you could do that. And maybe next year, we invite you, Mohan. And we have only complete advanced technology. Mohan, next time, complete advanced technology of the special effects, maybe we deal with maybe 1 hour, 1.5 hours.
Bring some technicians down.
Yeah. Right. We did it, you know, the man who did Bahubali was 1 year before in Pune. Some guy was there. He was next to the main person. And he brought all the videos and everything. And the last part is restoration. What he said is very important. And the kind of damages to the films done and all that. Every filmmaker, I think, from ESG to everybody. ESG had lost one complete film practically. Yash Chopra, very memorable film, but he got it again, the whole thing. One of my film was also by accident, a film which I made, and many people asked me, where is that film? I did a film with Rekha and Nasiruddin Shah in Kerala, with R.D. Burman's last music, Kishore Kumar's last song in the film, but somehow I could. And what happened was, I didn't tell you this, actually, in Bombay Lab, they had a last print. And it was through the water washing and all that. No? They used to wash the negative after making a print. They washed the negative, but after that, the drying was not properly done. And then all the watermarks came on the negative. And we thought it's okay. I mean, nobody even said, we said, okay, the print was there and the print running. And then we wanted to make a print. And when we saw it, AdLab people were shocked to see the negative was full of water bubbles. Could not restore it. I wasted 6 years in that. A film which you do so much of effort had practically gone. But then Pixion came up with some challenge, a French company in Mumbai. And frame by frame, they did again. And I'm very happy to tell you that the complete negative is restored frame by frame. A bit sound, everything. So now I got a film back. Only thing was, some problems in the running titles. So the running titles were difficult and we had to modify something. I could not to reshoot because now Rekha and Nasir have changed in last 10, 15 years. But now the film is ready And then, so that's a thanks to people who take all effort, take each and every frame and do it. So I always tell you that with the filmmakers, and only thing about the, perhaps the ratio you did not tell, maybe, you know, the 35mm life, what Academy Motion Picture has come out, the 35mm life is now, it's 95 years, okay? 100 years to 95. 95, they say, 100 years, but 100 years of 35mm life, if you store it properly, is 100 years. While the digital, what you're doing now, is 30 years?
No, it depends on your media, technology in the media.
But what do you call it today? Is LTO or something?
Data migration. No? Uh-huh. If you don't migrate your data properly according to the present technologies, then your content is lost. Like you don't see floppy disks anymore. What happens to all the data that were in front? Unless you have migrated, that's gone.
Suppose you just...
perpetual as it is supposed to be, if it's not migrated properly, then you're losing that also.
So, but the minimum life at least 20, 25 years there.
No, sir. It can be perpetual, but provided it's at that kind of a scalable resolution and the data has been migrated.
Oh, so it's very fast. So that means, you know, all the young filmmakers here were doing lot. I mean, she was asking about new cameras and all that. Take even the whatever possible RAID and all that. But you have to be very careful when you make the film, see your film, how it is after 1 year, 2 years, 3 years. That's what Mohan is saying. Thank you very much. And these are the three workshops we wanted to have. We have wonderful workshops. And next year, I think we'll have wonderful workshops again. That is what we want to keep Yashwant Film Festival. Because it's not only watching the films made in 16 and 17, last fresh films. We normally in film societies, we see old films and classics and all that. But here, we present classics, at the same time we are showing recent films. At the same time, whatever is happening in the film industry, with the films or digital technology, we would like to do the workshops. Thank you very much. We'll see the next film. Thank you, Mohan. It was really wonderful all the way you came from Chennai to us. And we trouble you a lot. Thank you. I give my love to Ramesh Prasad. It is the man who really holds this, all this, Ramesh Prasad. I tell you one thing, just a moment, sir. Can you believe it's so difficult for a person who is the best in the celluloid lab? Can you imagine that? Prasad lab has been the best lab in India for the 35mm processing. So much so, I remember Ramesh called me for one film. Are yahan karo thoda, ab Bombay mein kya karte ho? Can you ever believe that in Chennai, Prasad studio, a lobby which is at least 10 times longer than this, is there in Prasad lab, where you have to take your shoes out. You have to just walk barefoot to the lab. They were so careful about dust. So it was supposed to be the most dust-free lab, okay? And most of the great filmmakers, like Satyajit Ray to Mrunal Sen, to Bombay, Raj Kapoor, all people use Prasad lab. Yes. 19 times. And who did it? L.B. Prasad, the man. Can you know the by history that L.B. Prasad started his career with a silent cinema as an actor? He was a farmer's son, came to Mumbai, and he joined Bombay film industry, started with extra. And then he acted in the first talkie, Alamara. Yeah. But why this history is important? See, the whole transition. L.B. Prasad, from his silent era, came to Alamara, the talkie, then he became the director and the producer of many films of black and white. Hamrahi, Sasural, take name, all Prasad films like Sharada of Raj Kapoor, all big hits one after. Ek Duje Ke Liye, up to Ek Duje Ke Liye, Color. They're all done by Prasad ji. And then one day, Ramesh Prasad's son and his grandson Sai, they came to know that this celluloid, where they had about eight joints all over the country, all Prasad labs at eight places maybe. Yeah. Yeah. And then they came to know a very bitter truth that this celluloid is going to be redundant. Imagine having done so much of business, so much of loved over the celluloid, they knew that one day you have to shut down the business. But they were the first to come with a digital technology. Sai, they immediately adopted the new technique. And what today Mohan is saying, this Prasad Lab, today they are the best into the all post-production digital technology. This is what the man who started with Silent Era, his grandson can understand. It's nothing but, I tell you, passion for cinema. You love cinema, you do everything. Isn't it, Mohan?
Yes.
That's why, and one thing last, he was very particular, though he told you about, and especially for the new filmmakers, he told you about the digital technology can do wonders. He said that. But at the same time, he was again and again was saying that story is the main thing. Your basic shooting is the best thing. And what you do is, he used a word, though he's from that world, he said gimmicks, which is a very different. And all the digital technology, all the effects and everything, he called it gimmicks. So mind well, all the young filmmakers, that your basic story, basic shooting is very important. I finished one thing and then I had one Academy Award winner cameraman as the jury, Victor. And he gave a beautiful story and then I conclude. I asked him, he was 82 when he was my chairman, are you doing a photography? He said, Jabbar. Well, no, not much now. So I asked him, why? You know, historically, Victor had done, he had photographed all the Hollywood film actors. Al Pacino, Paul Newman, Gregory Peck, name anybody except one actor, Marlon Brando. He had not done a film with Marlon Brando. And when he came with his show reel, which is about 30 minutes, I could see all from Coma to all the classics he had done. And now the man said, no, I'm not much in it. So I asked him why. This is very, very important philosophically. He said, Jabbar, the thing is, I remember a film with Jennifer Jones and Burt Lancaster. I told you the story in Pune. I wanted to shoot one of the very important, very romantic part of a film was Burt and Jennifer had to kiss each other at a background of a sunset. He said, I went to the location of a sea. 10 days, I wanted a particular moment, what the director wanted. And I said, yes, now day will come where proper clouds will come. A proper shade of the sun will be there. And I called Burt and Jennifer that come. Director, camera, everything was ready. And luckily some birds also were there flying. So it was highly romantic. I said, yes, give action, there's action. They kissed very passionately. Director said, cut, okay. Victor, okay. He said, no, we have to come again tomorrow. There was something wrong in the cloud. They did 3 days, and after third day, the shot was okay, according to the cameraman. Director, it was okay. You know, he said, I took so much of pain with Burt Lancaster, was ready to do it. 3 days, come at 6 o'clock and do it. Today, they asked me, you can shoot at noon, there is no harm. There is no question of sun, I can bring in my DI, I can bring the sun there. How many clouds you want? I can bring one more cloud. You want some rains or something to come? Okay, rain can also drizzle in that. Or maybe some birds fly or something dreamy you want to clear. I wanted that particular moment. Now the DI people, all youngsters who have just learned DI, they say, yaar, aap kuch kar denge, aap kahin bhi shoot kar lo. Arre yaar, ye barish chahiye tha, barish nahi hai, wo kar lo. This was the whole thing. Ultimately, it doesn't help. The point is, when the young people come to me, sir, a picture banani hai. I said, okay. Kya kya hai? Sir, aap kahani suno. I said, okay, kahani suno. To kya kahani hai? You know, how today's young generation tell you story? There used to be a time when you used to say there is a bank employee. He's on the bus stand, like Amol Palekar. On a bus stand, he meets a girl or something like that. But nowadays, the young generation is sitting, all these five people, you know how they tell a story? Sir, I'm on a marine drive. And I have a steadicam with me. I walk with the steadicam. And then the girl is just moving there. And suddenly I see, I want to use a drone. And I fly, I take a drone. She's walking down, and the camera steadicam suddenly takes a jump. I go into dissolve, and she's walking. I go above her, and then there's a boy there. And that drone flies from there to the gate of India. So this is what the storytelling is, because they are thinking that drone, the steadicam, and panther, and then all the special effects move on. The story is they visualize in this way. Ultimately, I ask him, what is the story? So please, I know I'm not old-fashioned. I'm with all these changes, but please think, as Mohan said, the basic story. And if you see world cinema, you'll find the basic story remains the most important. Thank you very much.